Hi, I'm Jesper Pedersen from KDAB. Welcome back. We are talking about list views. And in the previous video, we got an introduction to what is the list view. You remember this column plus repeater. Now we're going to look at some of the features that list view has. I know all you want is to know about grid view. Don't worry. Most of what I'm going to tell you about the list view applies equally well to the grid view. So just do a bit of abstract thinking here so that you can follow on. We're going to talk about how do we decorate the list view. We're going to talk about how do we control the current item. Yes, I know in the previous video we did that, but that was manually controlling the current item. List view has support for that built in. And we're going to end this very video talking about how do we group things in a list view. So you have a list view with a number of items, but then those items go into groups that has their own decoration. So let's get started. By default, a list view is undecorated. There is just the item listing there. It's a flickable, meaning that you can take the item and with your finger flick it up and down, just like I do here. So flicking it up and down, and I can, had there been more than those five items in here, you would be able to see that I could just give it a good push and it would scroll for a while and then slow down again. It do support a number of things. So the first thing we'll see is how do we add a highlight. How do we add decoration? Okay, I have to ask for forgiveness. Sorry, I do have zero artistic skills. So when I'm drawing a decoration, it's a blue and a pink rectangle. That's all I can do. And that's what you see here in the screenshot. I have a decoration at the top. The decoration is specified using a property called header, and I got a footer down here. The current item is highlighted using another property called highlight. Let's see what all of this looks like in code. So here's my list view. I've seen that a number of times. I fill my parent. If this is the first time you see anger fill, gee, you should go back like 15, 20 videos and start there. I set up my model. So that's just as we saw in the previous video. I set up a delegate. That is how I paint each of my items inside the list view. I say focus true, because my list view actually support keyboard focus, not in slide viewer here because keyboard is stolen elsewhere. But when we run the real application, I'll show you that up and down already works out of the box with the list view. I say clip true. I will actually dedicate a video for discussing clipping in the list view. So we're going to see that in two videos. And here's the header. That's the beautiful pink line that I have up there. It's a delegate. It's an element here for the header property, and it anchors just so that it goes to the left and the right. I specify there's 10 pixels in height and the color is pink. So that's your header you got there. You got a footer, same thing as before. It's a rectangle. I anchor it, I give it a height, and I give it a color. And finally, there's the highlight here, which is also a rectangle, and that's the rectangle that you can see here. I anchor it to the left and the right, I give it a color, but I do not give it a height. There's nothing that says that my list view items, each of them need to be the same size. Well, same size in the width is a given, but the same size in the height, I could easily have different height list view. So therefore I can obviously not set the height in my highlight property. If I did, then it wouldn't match all of the items. So QML or the QListView will set the height. And let's just play a bit with this code and I can show you that, hey, you can actually customize each of the items so they have a different height. So bringing up my code here in Qt Creator. Here is my list view and my highlights specified down here. What I wanted to do was to change the height of each of the elements. I can do that. Here is my text element. Usually its height just comes from the implicit height of the text, but I can specify a height myself. I can spell height. There we are. Height, let's say index multiplied by, what do I know, by 2 plus 30. So you can see that the items get higher and higher. Not that obvious one. Let's go by 5. Let's make them much bigger. So here we have Alice. She barely got the 30 pixels. Then we got 35 for Bob and 40 and so on. You can see Wendy down here is a really big item. And you can, again, you can see the highlight for each of the items is matching exactly the element. Oh yeah, I promised you to also show you a keyboard. So now I press down arrow and up arrow on my keyboard. And well, when I get to the top, it doesn't go, it doesn't wrap around, but actually there is a property for that, which leads me right to the next slide, almost. It's a given that at some point you would like to go to the list view and ask the list view for what is your current item. And for that, we do have a current item element of the list view. So the item that is the current item, you can go to your list view and say, hey, current item, and that will give you an item. I was almost saying a pointer to an item, but we don't talk about pointers in QML. It'll give you the item, and due to the dynamic behavior of QML, you can go and read the properties from that. So over here, you can see Jane is current, Alice is current, and so on. Sometimes you want more than just the item in a list view. You want to group them in some way. So in this example here, we have crypto and QA and graphics and people working in different teams, and we group them by that. To do that, it's pretty straightforward. What you need to do is that you need to specify a property. I came up with the idea that that property should be called team. It's my idea. It's not something that QML dictate. I just need some property. I, for each of my list element, I specify this property. And then on my list view, there is a section.property. Here is my team. That's where I tell it, hey, it's a team that I look at here. Section.criteria, what should make it go to the next grouping? Is it a full string? So crypto and currency could be two different groups, or it could be the same, because the other alternative is view section dot first character, I believe it is called, which will make all of the C's go in the same group and all of the D's and so on. And then section dot delegate, that is again just an element that sets up this item here. And the only thing that comes in is a section, which tells me the name of the section I'm currently showing. Remember when I showed you the arrow up and arrow down 3 minutes ago? I told you at the top that I wouldn't go wrap around. There's actually a property specifying that, and that is a key navigation wrap, as you see here. If I set that to true, then I will wrap around. Now, the other topic we need to discuss in this slide here is highlight range mode. Highlight range mode. I got my list view. And in that list view, I got a number of items. And I can specify that the current item should be within a given area of that list view. So my current item cannot go outside of the list view. And that is what I specify with highlight range mode. Let me show you an example that makes it so much easier to understand what's going on. So I got this example running. You can see, let's just move it a bit. I cannot move it a bit. Well, you can see it here. You can see I got Alice, Bob, Harry, and so on. And when I move down here, you can see as soon as I start pressing arrow down on this item here, it will scroll except for Alice, who is at the edge of my list view. And similar for Wendy. So that's because that I set up this list view highlight range mode list view dot apply range, and I specify that it should be between 42 and 150. So that's 42 pixels from the top. That's where you see this red line here, and 150 pixels from the top. That's where you see the other red line here. And of course, those red lines is not something that's built into the list view. That would look pretty weird if you saw red lines in your list view like that. It's just something that I created. So let's just go up here and look at where, now down here, you can see I got two rectangles here. Both of them are red. They are both at position X. Their width is the parent.width, their height is 1 pixel. And the first one is at parent.preferred_highlight_begin, and the second is on parent.preferred_highlight_end. So it's just two rectangles that I put on top of my list view to give you an indication. But the key thing is that my current item will, when I have my list view.apply range, it will try very hard to make sure that my current item stays within that range. The only exception is if I actually get to the end so that I would show empty space above the current item. If I for all means need to have it in there, I can change it to strictly enforced range. And now when I'm running the application, you'll see that I do actually have white space up here. And when I move it around, I cannot get the current item to go outside of that area that is between preferred highlight begin and preferred highlight end. I know this is a bit of an advanced topic with the preferred highlight end and preferred highlight begin, or the other way around. One of the things you can do with it is if you want to have one of those thumb wheels, you know, one of those on your suitcase where you only see one number, you can have the current item being forced to be sitting there and just show just a half an item on each side, and the current item is forced to be shown, say 20 pixels into the list view and 20 pixels from the bottom, so that you will see the current item there sitting right in front of you all the time. That was it for this section here. In the next section, I'll go back to the grouping, and I will show you how you can actually collapse and open those groups with a bit of JavaScript magic. It's a bit off topic for the training material, but I just like that trick very much. So please do come back for the next video. Until then, have a great time.